Hi, everyone. Thanks for tuning into this episode of the Real Estate CPA Podcast. Today, your hosts, Brandon Hall and Thomas Castelli, here to talk about post-year-end tax planning. We did an episode before the year-end about what you can do prior to year-end to minimize your 2021 tax liability. But now we're in 2022. There are still some things left you can do to minimize your taxes. And that's exactly what we're going to talk about in today's episode. All right. So the first post-year-end tax planning tip we're going to talk about is the boring stuff, right? And that's going to be maxing out your IRAs. So you can max out a traditional IRA up until the tax filing deadline, which is April 15th, 2022. So if you've not made a contribution to your IRA, that's still very possible to do. And if you are in the threshold where you can have a deductible contribution, you can still get that deductible contribution after year end.
What about like backdoor Roth IRA conversions?
Yeah, so you can do a backdoor Roth IRA conversion at any time. So if you really wanted to right now, what you could do is you could go ahead and make a contribution of $6,000, that's the yearly limit, into your account for the 2021 tax year, and then immediately just do a conversion to a Roth IRA. So you can put the money into the traditional and then do the conversion to the Roth IRA right away. I mean, you could also put $12,000 in for 2021 and 2022 at the same time, do the Roth conversion, and now you can invest in the Roth and not have to worry about leaving it in the traditional IRA, putting it into a bunch of investments that may or may not accrue gains over the course of this year, and then later on do the conversion, and now all of a sudden you have a taxable event because the earnings portion of the conversion will be subject to tax.
And why would I want to do a backdoor conversion?
Yeah, so you might want to do a backdoor Roth IRA because basically what ends up happening is you're going to put money into investments over the course of the next 10, 15, 20, 30 years, however long your investment horizon is. And this money is going to hopefully grow substantially over that period of time. And then when you take that money out, you're not going to have to pay tax on it. Whereas if you did put into a traditional IRA, when you take that money out, you're going to have to pay tax on it. And that's taxed at the ordinary income tax rate. It's not taxed at the capital gains tax rate. So whatever the ordinary income rate is in retirement is going to be the rate that you're paying on the distributions from the traditional IRA. Whereas with the Roth, again, you're not paying any tax when it comes out. So the idea with the Roth, the backdoor Roth, is if you're over the phase out limits for the Roth IRA, you put the money into traditional IRA and then you immediately do a conversion into the Roth and then invest through the Roth. So you don't have to worry about any tax issues on the earnings portion from the traditional IRA.
Yeah. So you do take a tax hit on the monies that you're ultimately converting into a Roth. But the idea is that if you're growing this principal for 30 years and then you can take out all of that growth tax-free, then it's beneficial. And that's true even if you are in the highest tax bracket. At least that's the theory. I don't have any hard data points that I can point to right this second that shows whether or not it's beneficial for you, listener. But there is some risk, right? The IRS is aware of these transactions and they could invoke the step transaction doctrine, which basically says that, you know, you took a series of steps to avoid taxes, but in reality, you put after-tax money into a Roth IRA and you are over the phase-out limit. So we're going to disallow all of the steps in between and make you take the money out of the Roth IRA. They could, in theory, do that, in theory. But the other thing you got to watch out for is the Biden tax plan. Now, it's still in proposal mode as of this this recording. Manchin, Senator Manchin, is seemingly not negotiating with the White House or anybody on the Democratic Party, and things have seemingly fallen apart. But assuming that they pick the pieces back up and pass this bill, you will no longer be able to do a backdoor conversion. And they say that the date is December 31st, 2021. So after that date, you're no longer able to do a backdoor conversion. So if you're thinking about doing a backdoor conversion right now, my suggestion is to wait until we know if this Build Back Better plan, this tax plan, is going to pass or not, because they might update that date. They might not update the date, December 31st. And I don't know how it works. I actually didn't read that particular section. I just read the summary of that section. So I don't know procedurally if you are allowed to do a backdoor Roth conversion for the 2021 tax year in 2022, or if you're just simply not allowed to engage in any sort of backdoor Roth conversion after December 31st, 2021. So just be aware of the Build Back Better plan. It's got a potential blocker there for you. So if you go and engage in a Roth transaction today or Roth conversion today, you may be on the losing end of, or you may just set yourself up to fail, and you might not know that for, you know, a couple months. Just depends on how quickly we either get to a resolution on the Build Back Better plan, or it just completely falls apart and we have confirmation that it's actually fallen apart and Manchin is just not going to move on anything.
Right. There's a lot up in the air with that, unfortunately. So definitely keep an eye. I think somewhere in there said that they were going to disallow the Roth conversion on those with like AGIs above $400,000. I think there was like a number in there, so you might be safe. Got to double check that. But yeah, I mean, the bottom line is these things are still, you could still make contributions to a Roth or a traditional IRA pending your income and phase out limits until April 15th, 2022 for the 2021 tax year. So that's something that's still available to you. And if you can make deductible contributions to a traditional IRA, we're not going to go through all the rules here today in terms of phase outs and stuff because it gets complicated, but you can still make those contributions up until that point.
Yeah. Yeah. So maybe you just wait, right? Maybe that's the recommendation, is just wait until maybe early April. I don't like pushing things to, you know, April 14th, April 15th. So don't wait that long. But maybe first week of April, you know, if you want to do a backdoor Roth conversion, just wait until first week of April. I believe can't you even extend your returns and go all the way to the extended deadline?
Not with the contributions.
Not with the contributions.
That's stuck at the April 15th deadline, regardless of whether you extend or not.
Yeah. Okay. It's funny, man. I know Section 469 inside and out, but it's these little, it's almost like what I consider like the basic stuff that I forget the nuances. So glad to have you on the podcast. Oh,
well, the only reason I know is because I'm just drilling questions every day for the CFP, and literally I just finished the retirement account section. So
there you go. So yeah, Tom's studying for the CFP, everybody. I don't know if we announced that yet, but studying for the CFP, the Certified Financial Planner. Our goal is to open up a wealth management practice here at the Real Estate CPA so that we can help all of our clients with investment decisions, and both on the real estate side and on the equity side. So we're really excited about that.
Right. That's going to be super exciting when we're able to launch that. But just to keep it back on track here for what you can do post year end for tax planning. You can also, if you had opened up an HSA or already had an HSA account open prior to the end of 2021, you also have until April 15th to max out your contributions to your HSA. And those HSA contributions are tax deductible and there are no income limits. So it doesn't matter if you make, you know, $500,000 or you make $100,000, you make $2 million, contributions to HSAs remain tax deductible. So if you have one of those accounts and you have not maxed it out yet, there's still time to max out your HSA.
So I've got a practical question for you. And this kind of ties into taxes, and hopefully this will bring value to all of our listeners. So we just renewed all of our health plans at the firm here, and you know, we provide health care for our health plans. We cover the premiums for our employees. We're really excited about this year because now we're covering 100% of premiums for our employees, as long as you're on that high deductible plan, and then we basically apply that premium to everything else. Anyway, that's beside the point. But so I'm looking at the 3 health plans we have, right? And the for me, because I have a family, I have a spouse and 2 kids, you know, the premium goes from $430 a month to like $1,200 a month, which is ridiculous. On the I guess that's a premium cost or a different conversation. $1,200 a month for the high deductible health plan, but then the super low deductible health plan, so our third health plan, the Cadillac health plan. I don't want to say Cadillac, Ferrari, Rolls Royce. Let's do that. Bentley health plan. Our Bentley health plan is, or McLaren maybe. What's like a super extremely, super Allegra? I don't know. Anyway, we'll go. The McLaren health plan has a $1,500 a month premium. Okay. So I was sitting here and I actually did this myself, but I should have asked you. So now I'm going to just ask you if I did the right thing, and we're going to do this live and you get to tell me if I did or not in front of our, what do we have? 70,000 listeners a month.
Yeah.
I chose the big plan instead of the high deductible plan. So I'm paying an extra $300 a month for the McLaren plan, which has a much lower deductible, $3,000 deductible, versus the high deductible, like $9,000 or whatever deductible was. But I can't contribute to the HSA. So I'm paying $3,600 more in premiums,
right,
for a lower deductible plan, 100% coinsurance after the deductibles hit. But our high deductible plan is the same thing. Once you hit the deductible, the $9,000 deductible, 100% coinsurance. But I'm giving up that HSA contribution and the tax deductions associated with it. How do you analyze something like that? Because I was like, $3,600 extra, I'll just go with that. But then I was like sitting there thinking, like, yeah, but if I could sock away money, because how much can you put into an HSA for a married couple?
For a married couple, I'm pretty sure it's $7,300 for a family. So $7,300 per year.
It's just, I thought that was single. That's not double. That's not.
So
that's
single, not... single is $3,650.
Okay. So 7,000 something times 37%.
We're looking at 2,700.
So $2,700 in tax savings. If I socked away, if I maxed out the HSA, the earnings can then grow tax-free. Then I can use that. I can use those earnings to pay for, you know, healthcare stuff. Right. Did I do the right thing? Did I do the right thing by paying an extra $3,600 a year in premiums and foregoing this HSA contribution?
Yeah, you know, that's a good question. You know, I'd have to put everything probably down in an Excel spreadsheet and look at the numbers. But I think if you have a family, right, and you have two young kids, you're probably going to have more out-of-pocket expenses. You're going to have more healthcare-related expenses throughout the year. So having that lower deductible probably makes more sense, because if you go, you know, once you hit that deductible, you're not paying out-of-pocket anymore, right? So I would say probably if you have a kid, you have to look at what your healthcare costs are going to be for the year and do an analysis to determine what would make the most sense. But with two young kids, I would imagine you're going to hit the deductible, and then whatever's beyond that, you're not going to have to pay. And you're going to be in a better position in the long run in terms of reducing healthcare costs today.
So if the HSA plan was I think it was $9,000 for a single person, and it was $18,000 for a family. So maybe that was the big difference. And then the McLaren plan was $3,000 deductible, $6,000 family. But I don't even know how that stuff works, man. Cause like each, my spouse and myself both have our own deductibles. I don't know. Super confusing. But I guess the way that I was thinking about it, if I was single, the way that I'd be thinking about it was if I added an extra $3,600 in premiums to reduce my risk, my healthcare risk, what's the spread on the deductible on the HSA plan versus the deductible on the McLaren plan? The spread's $6,000. So if I pay more in premiums, then I reduce my risk of having to pay $6,000 out of pocket. But at the same time, I can even hedge that further by contributing to an HSA. I don't know, man. It's so confusing.
Yeah, there's a lot of analysis.
That's why you hire CPAs, folks.
Yeah, look, there's a lot of analysis that has to go into it for making, you know, a decision for each and every person, depending on what, you know, what their healthcare costs are going to be for the year and stuff like that. Yeah. But I can say the reason why I went with the high deductible healthcare plan is because I'm single, and knock on wood, I'm pretty healthy. So I have virtually no healthcare costs that come out of pocket each year. And with that said, it just makes more sense to be on a high deductible healthcare plan and just put money into an HSA because I have no costs. Now, having said that, if I had kids, I know that I would have healthcare costs that I would have to pay, and I would have to do an analysis to determine, okay, well, here's the amount I expect to probably pay, you know, out of pocket for, you know, healthcare costs between deductibles and all that, versus how much would I be able to save with the HSA, and I have to do an entire analysis to figure that out.
Nah, dude, I just told my kids to sweat it out.
Yeah,
they're 3 months and 3 months and 2 years old, but sweat it out, you'll be fine.
Yeah, I mean,
daddy's not spending money on healthcare.
Daddy chose the high deductible healthcare plan this year, and we're not going to the doctor. Okay, so you sit tight.
All right, so you can retroactively contribute to an HSA.
So you could do it after year end. So you can do it up until April 15th for 2021.
So here's a cool tax strategy for everybody to remember. Let's say that you didn't contribute to your HSA last year. You didn't make any contributions. Okay. And because you didn't make any contributions, you know, you might be thinking, oh, well, I paid for all these healthcare costs, but because I didn't make any contributions, I can't deduct anything. And that's not true. you can retroactively make that contribution. So you can recapture that spend. And there's a whole, you know, you can contribute and then immediately distribute it back to yourself, which is also beautiful because you can reimburse yourself for healthcare costs that you paid out of pocket from an HSA.
Right.
So if you didn't use the HSA, you can put money into it and then immediately take it back out. You know, don't do it without talking to a CPA first, but really neat tax strategy. We actually used to deploy that all the time with our clients. I don't know if we still do on the with the planning, but
yeah, I mean, I think we do in certain situations when it comes to more of like that type of like retirement-esque planning. But a lot of our planning these days has to do a lot about focusing on how to reduce taxes with real estate specifically. But if that's something somebody wants to talk about, we're more than happy to bring that to the table. One of the HSA strategies a lot of people use, I'll throw this in there, is what they do is they max out their HSAs every year. They go ahead and they invest their HSAs, and then they save their receipts, their medical for their medical expenses, and they just accumulate their receipts, and hopefully they store them somewhere safe. And then their plan is to let their money grow in the HSA, and then at some point later on down the line, they're going to go ahead and reimburse themselves for all their medical expenses, because there is no deadline at this moment of when you have to reimburse yourself. So, you know, I can incur an expense, a medical expense in 2021 or 2022 and wait until 2044 to go ahead and reimburse myself for those expenses. And that would leave the principal intact within the HSA account to continue to grow through whatever investment vehicle you choose, and then later on take it out. So that is an option. People do that. Or to Brandon's point, some people will make the contribution after year end and then reimburse themselves for expenses they incurred the prior year after year end. So there's a lot of flexibility in how you use that plan. But for right now, just know that you could still go ahead and make a contribution if you haven't already.
You just said do that.
Do that.
You said doo-doo on the podcast. Well, once you hear it, you can never unhear it, right? So I do this all the time, and my wife calls me out on it, because I'll be like, yeah, people do that all the time. She'll be like, oh, they do? And, and now that I hear that, I'm like, oh, I can't unhear it. Anyway, don't cut this part. Anyway, good stuff. All right, what else you got for us?
All right. So we get this question a lot from clients all the time. And that's, you know, can you do a cost segregation study after year end, or do you have to do it prior to the year coming to a close? And, you know, the answer to that question is, if you have purchased a property, let's say, for example, in 2021, you place that property in the service, which is typically means it's listed and rent ready, if not already rented. And then that property is going to be reported in your 2021 tax return as a rental property on Schedule E, or the 8825 if you're a partnership or S Corp, et cetera, we're not going to go into all those details. But the cost segregation study does not have to be performed in 2021. It has to be performed. It can be performed in 2022 as long as it's ready to be reported on your 2021 tax returns by the tax filing deadlines, including extensions. So that's going to be by April 15th if you're an individual and you don't extend your return, or it'll be by October 15th if you're an individual and do extend your return, or by March 15th if you don't extend and you're an entity such as a partnership, or until September 15th if you are an entity to extend. So you have until the deadline, again, including extensions, to have the cost segregation study performed and reported on your tax return. You do not have to do it in 2021. The key is the property just needs to be placed in service in 2021.
Now, why do they have such a big, like, why is this even a thing? Because we get this all the time. Like, people come to us, well, why do I need to do this? Let me ask you another way. We will have people come to us that say, why do I need to do this before the end of the year? Why do I need to do a cost study before the end of the year? Why, what's prompting them to do that?
I think it's just people, you know, see 12/31 is a cliff, and that the study for some reason needs to be completed before the end of the year in order to report it on your 2021 tax return. Sometimes it is the year end planning rush, I suppose, but I don't know where that question comes from, other than just the 12/31 cliff. And most people, you know, might not know that this is something that can actually be done after the fact.
Yeah, I think there's another factor as well, which is the cost segregation companies pushing people to to do a cost segregation study before the end of the year. And the reason that they're doing that is they're just trying to hit year-end sales numbers, right? So, I mean, all of our companies, our company included, we have a 12/31 cutoff. And if we want our revenue and profitability to look really good so that we can, you know, pay our partners out, pay big bonuses to our staff, then we have to try to do a push at the end of the year. Well, cost seg companies are doing that as well. So just be aware of that, and it's not malicious. It's not a bad thing. It's just that you don't have to do a cost segregation study within the same year that you acquire the property. You can do it, like Tom said, all the way up until you file your tax return on October 15th or September 15th. If we're talking about a company that has an extended deadline of September 15th.
Right. Yeah. I didn't even think about that, but yeah, I mean, cost segregation studies, like every other company, if they're on the cash basis, they want to try to get as much revenue in as they can before the end of the year. And their sales reps probably want to make their numbers too. So they want to get everything in. So
right, they're trying to get big commission checks for Christmas and stuff like that. Right.
Yeah. And they're not necessarily doing you a disservice. Like you said, if you do it before year end, that's fine. But if you do it year after, end, that's fine too. In fact, you can even do it several years after the fact, but it does come with lot. It does come with more reporting complexities, and does usually increase your tax filing costs if you wait too long. So the bottom line is you want to get it done for the year and reported for the year you acquired the property and placed in the service. So that would be 2021. You don't have to do it in 2021, but you want to usually have it done for that first year when you originally placed that property in the service, to keep everything streamlined as possible. All right, so we have another one here, and that's going to be making retroactive S-Corp election. This is usually something that small business owners, if you're a consultant, maybe you're a real estate agent, you're a property manager, basically any type of business where you're generating revenue and you're a small business, the S-Corporation may make sense for you to help you minimize your exposure to the self-employment taxes, which is currently 15.3% on the first, I believe it's $141,000 or so of income in 2021. So you can make a retroactive S corporation after year end is another tax planning tool you can use.
Yeah. And so let's talk about why you would want to do that, right? And who can actually do that? First, you have to have an LLC or a C corporation set up. So you got to have an LLC or a C corp set up. You can't retroactively tax your sole proprietorship as an S corporation, right? It's a tax election on an entity that already exists. That's right. The key. So if you've been running everything out of your own name, you don't have an LLC or a C corp or whatever set up, then this is not going to apply to you. It could apply to you this year though, so pay attention. Now, when do you want to do this? You only want to run an S corporation if you have earnings from self-employment. And the reason for that is that your earnings are subject to a 15.3% self-employment tax. When you're a W-2 employee, you pay 7.65%. Your employer pays the other 7.65%. And that's what's always funny about like how these rich people never pay taxes, but in reality, their companies pay millions and millions and millions and millions of dollars in Social Security and Medicare taxes every day. But nobody talks about that because it's the hidden tax that nobody talks about. Even people that prepare their own taxes, and they're like, oh, my effective tax rate's so low. I'm immediately like, yeah, but what'd you pay in Social Security and Medicare taxes? Because everybody forgets about this extra 7.65% tax that they're paying on their wages every single month. So you pay 7.65%, your employer pays 7.65%. When you're self-employed, for purposes of the Internal Revenue Code, you are treated as an employee and the employer. So you get the lovely benefit of paying both halves for yourself. So you pay 7.65 as the employee and another 7.65% as the employer, total 15.3% tax. That's called the self-employment tax. So if you're a wholesaler, if you are a real estate agent, if you are a flipper, a builder, even arguably a capital raiser, you could be in a self-employment situation where you are having to pay a 15.3% tax on your earnings. And you would want to route those earnings through an S corporation so that you can reduce your exposure to that 15.3% tax. You're not going to be able to eliminate it If you are eliminating that 15.3% tax, congratulations, you will most likely be getting an audit letter within the next 3 years. They are ramping up audits on S corporations. It's an audit priority. They're hiring more people, more revenue agents to come in and audit S corporations. Make sure you're paying yourself a reasonable salary. We have done a ton of content on reasonable salaries in the past. So feel free to go and try to find prior podcasts, check out our YouTube channel. If you need help, we have a whole system that we've developed to help people with it. So you can check us out at therealestatecpa.com. But reasonable salary, you got to pay yourself a reasonable salary. And whatever you pay yourself is subject to that 15.3% tax, but the extra avoids it. So if I've got $100,000 of net income from flipping real estate or from flipping real estate or flipping homes, and I'm running that on a Schedule C, sole prop, or even a single member LLC, I'm going to pay $15,300 in self-employment taxes, and then I'm going to pay my marginal tax rate on the $100,000, and then I'm going to pay my state tax rate on the $100,000. So I'm easily in, you know, the 50% or so tax bracket, or 50% tax rate. That's probably not true. My effective tax rate, every dollar that I earn, I'm probably more like 30 or so percent. But I'm a lot higher as a self-employed business owner. On every dollar of earnings, my effective tax rate is going to be a lot higher than a W-2 employee because I have this self-employment tax burden. So if I shift that 100K into an S corporation, maybe I determine that my reasonable salary is $50,000. So I pay myself a $50,000 W-2 wage. You have to run payroll. You have to do this all legitimately. You can't just do it haphazardly. It's all going to be legit. Pay myself 50K W-2 wage. That is subject to 15.3% tax, that self-employment tax. The additional $50,000, because remember, I earned 100K total, 50,000 is being paid out as a W-2. The remaining 50K just sits in my S corporation checking account. I can distribute that out to myself. It's considered a cash dividend, and it avoids that 15.3% self-employment tax. In this example, when I was running everything on a Schedule C, my $100,000 was subject to a $15,300 self-employment tax. When I moved it into an S corporation, paid myself 50K of W-2 wages, the remaining 50K is taken out as profit. My self-employment tax is $7,650. I've cut it in half. I've saved $7,600 by moving it to an S corporation. But you have to have an LLC set up. If you don't have an LLC set up and you want to do this year, go set up an LLC today. Go do it right now. It does not take long. You do need an article. You do need to make sure that you do it correctly from a legal protection standpoint, you know, but you can go to the Secretary of State website and set up an LLC in a matter of maybe 30 minutes tops. So you can go do that today. Today would be your start date that you could retroactively tax an S corporation on, right? So you can only go back as far as that start date of the LLC and up to 3 years and 75 days, I think is what you can use.
Yeah, and something I want to throw in there, we've gotten some confusion out there recently with some folks, I think, in the Tax Smart Investor community or some potential clients we were working with. I forgot exactly where it came from, but here's how this works, right? So for 2021, if you wanted to execute this for 2021, you would have had to have an LLC set up in 2021 and received the revenue in the name of that LLC. So say you had a single member LLC, and you received all your income through the single member LLC, then you'll be able to make that retroactive S corporation on the single member LLC. But like Brendan said before, if you're a sole proprietor, and let's say I'm a sole proprietor, my name is Thomas Castelli, and I receive all my money in my personal name, I cannot go back and retroactively do that. So to Brendan's point, if you want to execute this strategy in 2022, what you're going to want to do is set up an LLC. And start receiving the revenue in the name of the LLC now so that you can make the S corp election right away, or you can wait until after the year, or you can wait closer you get to year end, or even after year end to make the S corp election for 2022. But the key is the LLC has to be there and you have to receive the money in the name of the LLC. Okay. Yeah.
And to actually add on that real quick, you know, so sometimes we get people that hear about this strategy and it's like November and they're like, okay, well, I'll just go set up an LLC real quick.
Right.
Well, that's great, but you can only retroactively tax the S corp to the date that you started the LLC and that you started running income through the LLC. So if you set up an S corp on November 1st, then all of the income that you've earned prior to November 1st is not eligible to be routed through the LLC, the S corp strategy, right? So it's only November, December. So it's it's not going to be beneficial unless you have the LLC set up in the beginning of the year, at the beginning of the year. So you really need, if this is appealing to you right now and you don't have an LLC set up, you need to go do that now. And again, make sure that you handle the legal stuff too. You really need an operating agreement to lock your LLC down and protect it from creditors. So make sure that you do double check on that side too. We're just telling you the tax piece, but there are a couple caveats that I want to highlight. Anytime that you retroactively tax something as an S corporation, you have to run payroll. And anytime you retroactively run payroll, you're going to be subject to potential penalties for late payroll runs, right? If I tax my LLC as an S corporation today, now it's January 2022. So I'm going to retroactively tax my S corp, you know, for all of 2021, I'm going to treat it like an S corp. And now I'm going to run this retroactive big one-time payroll to reclassify all of my 2021 distributions to myself as wages or a portion of them as wages. But now what I'm doing is I'm just submitting late payroll. Okay. And that's going to subject me to penalties. It's going to subject me to IRS letters and state letters. So I've just got to be prepared for that. The penalties are not large first time. Typically first time you can work with the states, especially to get them abated. But you're going to have an additional administrative headaches is my point. It's going to take some time for you. You're also going to have to set up payroll. Typically you can use like a software. We always recommend using Gusto, G-U-S-T-O. I think it costs like $400 or $500 a year. You're also going to have to pay for an S corporation tax return, form 1120-S. And that's going to cost you probably $1,500 a pop, even on the simplest businesses. So you got to factor in the costs. Okay. So there's costs involved. If you budget $2,100 to $2,200 a year, you're probably safe. So you want to make sure that your tax savings exceed that, which is why you hear CPAs say, hey, you really need to be netting like $60,000-$70,000 in your business before running this S corporation makes sense. So just factor in the costs, factor in the additional administrative time, especially the first year. You're going to get letters. People hate getting letters. Just be aware that that's going to happen. And then make sure that you have a conversation with your CPA about the qualified business income deduction. We're not going to go into that right now, but an S corporation does impact your ability to claim or impacts the amount of that QBI deduction that you can claim on your taxes. So please, please make sure that you touch base with your CPA before you make an S corporation election.
Right, 100%. And one last thing I want to say on S corporations before we move on is that, yes, you can use, we did a lot of talking here on this podcast about setting up an LLC and taxing it and retroactively having it taxed as an S corporation. That's a perfectly legitimate way to go about using an S corporation, but you can also just use a plain S corporation if you wanted to. Now you wouldn't be making a retroactive election or anything like that on an S corporation, but using an S corporation itself would be effectively the same thing from the tax side. So I just want to make that clear. You can use an S corporation or you can have an LLC and tax the LLC as S corporation. But anyway, moving on to one last thing we want to mention here for post-year-end tax planning, and that is gathering your time logs for the real estate professional status or short-term rentals. If you're trying to prove that you materially participated in your short-term rental activity, you want to make sure that you have those time logs set and ready to go now if you haven't already did that last year, because the longer and longer you get away from the prior year, the more and more time passes, the harder and harder it's going to be for you to accurately create a time log that reflects what you did the prior year. Like I always say, I've mentioned this in other podcasts, you know, as a CPA, I'm used to tracking time, and, you know, trying to track time from last week is a challenge. You know, if you didn't write everything down and you didn't take good notes and everything, or you didn't have a really good calendar system set up to go back and look at what you did. So I could only imagine for people who aren't used to tracking their time on a regular basis, how hard that might be to try to go and do it accurately. And remember, the IRS and the task force, they're going to be looking at your log and they're going to see, is this credible and is this a reasonable log? And they know that people will go and retroactively create it. And if they sniff out that it was retroactively created and it doesn't look credible, they can throw out your entire position. So the bottom line is, if you haven't already completed your time logs for 2021, if you're looking to make a real estate professional election or you're looking to materially participate in your short-term rentals to make the losses non-passive, then you're going to want to make sure those logs are clean and buttoned up probably very soon. I wouldn't wait much longer than January to get it done if you haven't already. So we just launched the 2022 TaxSmart Bootcamp with nearly 200 students. And we had a lot of people asking, if they could still register. And unfortunately, registration for the January 2022 bootcamp is closed. And we'll be doing another one at some point later on this year. The date is to be determined. But you know what? You really don't have to wait and to get TaxSmart. You can actually still get TaxSmart today by signing up for the Tax Strategy Foundation course that Brandon created. And you can find that by going to courses.therealestatecpa.com. And you can use promotional code RECPA, so it's capital RECPA, to get $100 off that course. Just like the bootcamp, it covers the real estate professional status, short-term rentals, repairs and improvements. And it also goes much further than that and covers things like entity structuring, cost segregation studies, paying your children, and a lot more. The tax basics are all in there. So you don't need to wait for the next TaxSmart bootcamp to become TaxSmart. You can go ahead and register and enroll in the course, which is open all the time. And you can do that by going to courses.therealestatecpa.com and use promo code RECPA for $100 off. We'll see you in the course, but until then, happy investing.